morning, Sabbath School members.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath to one and all. It is a privilege to welcome you all to another Sabbath service this morning. Let us not forget that today is our prayer and fasting day, and there are lots to pray for. But we want to place in a special way our building project. Yes, we are building for the future, and that's the theme for this day today. And we are building a future with Jesus spiritually, with his help, of course, but we also need the help and direction with this physical building as well. We want to seek God's plan for us. It says, seek God's plan, not his blessing for our plan. Christ Object Lesson 146 says, it is not the capabilities you now possess or ever will have that will give you success. It is only that which the Lord can do for you. We need to have far less confidence in what man can do and far more confidence in what God can do for every believing soul. He longs to have you reach after him in faith. He longs to have you expect great things from him. So let's invite God's presence to be with us here this morning as we conduct the Sabbath School. And in doing so, we will ask Sister Jackson to offer the open prayer for us. Could we stand, please, for prayer? There's a blue mic.
Pray. Our kind and ever loving Father, again we come before thee to give thee thanks and praise. Father God, we thank you for life, for health, for strength, and the movement of our bodies. Help us, dear Jesus, as we gather together today, your holy Sabbath day, to remember, as you've told us, to remember the Sabbath day, to keep it holy. But not only on a Sabbath day, but to keep it holy throughout the 7 days that you have set for us to obey. Lord, bless each and every one of us as we gather here in your temple. And remember those that are still traveling on the road there, Lord. Give them the strength, guidance, and protect them to get them here safely, that we'll all study together. Father God, bless, guide, and protect. Help us all to live closer to thee more and more each day, because the time is running out and we don't know when you're going to knot our hearts string. So bless us all, dear Lord, and give us a pleasant Sabbath day, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We will remain standing for our opening hymn, which will be hymn number 8. We gather together.
Sing.
To gather together to ask the Lord's blessing, he chastens and hastens his will to make known. The wicked oppressing now cease from distressing, sing praises to his name, he forgets not his own. Beside us to guide us, our God with us joining, ordaining, maintaining his kingdom divine. So from the beginning, the fight we were winning, the Lord was at our side, all glory. We all do extol thee, thou leader triumphant, and pray that thou still, Lord defender, will be. Let thy congregation salvation, escape tribulation, thy name be ever praised, O Lord, make us thine.
Okay, please be seated. Okay, we are about to go into our lesson study for today, and it's the first lesson study for the quarter, and the title is Jesus Wins, Satan Loses. So we are with Jesus, so we are on the winning side. Yes, we are on the winning side. I think Sister Fenton is going to stand in for us today. She's going to facilitate until.
Good morning, everyone, and a happy Sabbath to you all. Okay, so here we are today in God's house. We want to thank him for all that he has done for us this week. We want to thank him for his word more than anything else. His word that he has given us to study, to remind us of his many blessings that he has and he wants to pour on us. As Sister Anne has said, we have now started a new topic, a new quarter, and the title is The Three Cosmic Messages, The Three Angels' Messages. Messages that as Adventists, a lot of us, we understand, but there are things and from time to time that we need to be reminded about. And so this quarter, the lesson was written by Mark Finley. I guess everybody here, you may know. Those online, not everybody may know, but Mark Finley has been a great writer and a provider of content for the studying of God's word. And so this week, we are focusing on Jesus wins, Satan loses. And the whole three angel messages came around in the Adventist Church in 1844. And it says here, the three angels' messages are, in a sense, the marching orders of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And at their core, they are the gospel, pure and simple, but the gospel presented in the context of present truth. The gospel presented in the context of present truth. Can someone read for me 2 Peter 1 and verse 12? 2 Peter 1 and verse 12. Anybody who has, anybody can read it. 2 Peter 1 and verse 12. Put your hand up so that when, okay, Sister De Silva has her hand up.
Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they do minister the things which are now reported mm-hmm. unto you by them
That's
that
right.
have preached the gospel mm-hmm. unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things that angel desired to look into.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm just going to look at the introduction before Brother Hezron comes up and presents the lesson to you. Okay, so Jesus wins, Satan loses. It says here for the overall, I'm just going to look at the overview for this lesson. Our lesson this week focuses on the great controversy between good and evil down through the centuries, Revelation 12 presents four great episodes of the conflict. They are Lucifer's rebellion in heaven, his attempt to destroy the infant Jesus, his attack on God's people during the Middle Age, and his final attack on God's remnant people in the last days. In each of these conflicts, Christ is revealed as our victorious Lord, our triumphant Redeemer, and our mighty conqueror. I leave it there, and Hezron will come up and take it from here. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. And forgive me, I've been in a rush. I've been doing some of everything this morning. And sometimes you have to just remember Sabbath is Sabbath because it is supposed to be a day of rest. Let's pray. Father God, I pray that as we deliberate over these words, this exciting lesson, that your spirit would be with us. And that we would remember this is not just a cerebral exercise, but it's actually our destiny, which is what we're talking about. Let us take it seriously and to do something about it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we've all studied our lesson this week. And our lesson is very straightforward in terms of saying that Jesus wins. Now, everybody loves a story of the underdog, so winning over an adversary. So what you find is in films, for example, films are normally about, you know, for example, when somebody is disadvantaged or doesn't have much, but they're able to overcome circumstance to the point where they are able to achieve what was not expected of them. We all kind of like, everybody likes to see the triumph of the weak over the strong or the disadvantaged over the oppressor. However, some of us like to see it, but when it comes to doing it for ourselves, that's something else. And in these days where health and safety is a big issue, we would be, how might I say? We would be forgiven for probably thinking, well, this person has not really thought this through very well, and perhaps they should have thought about this or abandoned this crazy idea that they wanted to, of something they wanted to achieve. Now, historically, most of us have heard of Alexander the Great and his conquests. And this was a young man who conquered the then known world by the age of 25. He had expanded his army, and legend would have us believe that unless his army had stopped him, he would have continued to go until he basically dropped dead. Also, you would have heard of Hannibal Barca, who was the ruler of Carthage, which is modern-day Tunisia. In about 200 BC, he and his men crossed the Alps with elephants, and they gave Imperial Rome a very hard time. And they were able to achieve unfathomable feats of military conquest. These aren't in the lesson, but I cast my mind on more recent conquests. You've heard of Toussaint Louverture, a French slave. Well, and an enslaved man who became the first ruler of Haiti. It was formerly known as Hispaniola, and he was able to successfully beat Napoleon Bonaparte. And the history books try to gloss over this, But this is somebody coming from slavery and obscurity to be one of the most formidable military geniuses of all time. Okay, so let's dive in. I think my questions I don't have on me, but I think I probably left my phone in the car, but let's proceed anyway. So in our Sabbath lesson, Satan loses. Sorry, the Sunday's lesson, Battle in Heaven. Now, we're all familiar with the narrative of what happened eons ago, before time, as we know it, the epic battle between Lucifer, as he was then known, and Jesus, who he considered to be as Michael. And I don't know if you've ever considered, many of the films that we watch are loosely based on this sort of drama. You've ever watched Star Wars? You don't have to admit it, but this is a film that's been out since 1977, and it has a franchise that still goes on, and the base is the same, good versus evil, about a big cosmic conflict that's going on. And what we understand is that this conflict has been going on for our part for at least 6,000 years, and even much more after that. And what we want to do is to just, sorry, Sister Marcia, I don't know if you still have my questions, but I don't have my questions with me to ask people. I don't know if you've still got it with you. I did. Okay, also my young assistant is bringing what I need. Yeah. Thank you so much. Oh, that's okay.
I scrolled over there.
That's okay. Yes. All right, thanks. Yes. Thank you, sir. Yes. Thanks. All right. Just give me a moment. All right. Okay. So in the interest of time, there's so much in this lesson that the time will not justify us to get through it. So we're going to try and get through as quickly as possible. I'm going to ask, who was the first person to read? Yes. Sister Castor here? No. Okay. Can I have... Okay, then. So Revelation chapter 12, 7 to 9. Please. Thank you.
I read. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought against his angels, and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, the old serpent, called the devil, and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
Thank you so much. And what the Sunday section is really dealing with is the reality of free will, or having free will. How could such a devastating occurrence happen in a place that is perfect? Well, free will. God has made us free will and free moral agents, as he has done the angels, which means is that there is always the possibility that you can go against him. However, for love to exist, you must have the ability to choose it. Otherwise, you are a robot, or in antiquity was known as an automaton. You're not making a choice. You are simply following instinct. But the fact is that God, even knowing what would happen, he still offered all his creatures the ability to choose. So my question to Elder Davidson is, what are the implications and realities of God giving us free will? What does it reveal of God's character and our responsibilities as free moral agents? Elder Davidson, please.
Yeah.
Thank you, brother teacher. In addressing the question you raised here, which I'm supposed to deal with, I firstly would want to just get my head around the two key words there, implications and realities. In terms of implication, we're looking at what is hinted or suggested at. We're looking at expectation, what's expected in terms of or behavior and so forth. And reality is a little bit different now. It's about what's real, what has happened. So in addressing your question, what are the implications and the realities of God giving us free will? Firstly, I'll say in terms of implications, we are expected to choose to love God and to obey his commandments. That's the expectation. Love cannot be forced, as you mentioned before, or demanded. Love has to be freely given and over. So in a sense, the ball, when it comes to that, the ball is in our court. We choose to obey God or to disobey God. That's what's the implications are. The objective really is for us to choose good, choose to obey God, choose to follow his will, etc. Yes. That's what is expected of us. But then the realities, and that's different now. The reality is, although we are in control and should be control of our actions and our behavior, oftentimes we make bad decisions in our lives. Mm-hmm. That's the reality. Yes. We have the choice.
Yes.
But often we make bad decisions. Mm. And I say to us that our action and behavior originate from our hearts and our minds.
Yes.
Because all you feel and what you think will determine what you do.
Yes.
And so in terms of making those bad decisions or good decisions, we need something in our lives to help us, although we have free choice. And so I say to us in terms of the lesson, Jesus is the winner. He gives us the support we need, mercy, grace, etc., that the Spirit of God in our hearts. If we have the Spirit of God in our hearts, it will help us to make those wise decisions, those choice that is better for us and better for others. And you know, we struggle all the time. Even today I struggle. I was coming here in Uber and I took it, and when the man came, the driver came, I realized I left my charger for my computer. So I asked him if I could just nip back quickly to get it from the house, because it's just across the road. And he was very difficult. He didn't want, in the end I said, okay, leave it. And you know, when you take Uber, when you're in the car later on, a thing will come up on your screen to say if you wanted to give a tip to the driver.
That probably didn't happen that day.
And my thought said, no, I'm not gonna give this driver a tip. But you know, I said, but I'm going to church and the Sabbath school lesson is about doing good. And so I changed my mind. I said, I have to got to do the right thing. So we struggle daily because I wanted to maybe take revenge. But that is not what we should do. We shouldn't do that. We should love our neighbors. And even our enemies we should love. So, you know, even today, I was learning something from the lesson. Thank you, Brother Teacher. I hope that makes some sense.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much for that. I can entertain maybe one or so comments, but time is really against us. Okay, all right, we'll move on to Mondays. Satan's attack. So the lesson teaches us, from the very beginning, Satan has tried to attack us. And the thing is with Satan, he doesn't fight fair, he fights very dirty. If he can't get you directly, he'll go after someone who's close to you, and he'll go full scale. So when I'm thinking about the story when Herod killed all the baby boys, in just seeking the one child, thousands died. And that's how Satan fights. He's cowardly in the fact he won't just come for you. If he sees your life is going in a particular trajectory, you're making the effort in the faith of Jesus to move forward, he'll touch something that's close to you. It might be a member of family. More often than not, it probably is, or a close friend. And anything to destabilize your sensibilities, that's what he will do. But what we see about Jesus is that he likens the church to a bride, to a beloved, to his beloved. That's how he likens the church. And so therefore is an object lesson. It seems they're all aimed at men, but hey, in how to love the church. And we have a key of, we've got several, what's it, several descriptions. The dragon, the woman, the male child, and a rod of iron. Let's just read the verse pertaining to that before we have it explained by our participants. So for Monday, we'll read Philippians 3, verse 9, please. Is Sister Tumela here?
Three, verse nine.
And be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, and righteousness which is of God by faith.
Thank you so much. There are some other verses which pertain to the symbols which have been drawn out, the dragon, the woman, the male child, the rod of iron. But in the interest of time, we won't go into that because I believe that we all know what those mean. Before we ask the question, first of all, the dragon, who is or what is the dragon representing? Satan. And the woman? The church. The male child. Okay. And the rod of iron? Authority, unbreakable dominance or rulership. Okay, fine. So our question to, who's this to? Sorry, I'm a bit all over the place today. That's what happens when you try to multitask, which I'm not that good at. Okay, just a moment. So our question to Elder Pilgrim is, what confidence can we have in Christ's triumph over Satan as it relates to our salvation? Also, what is required of us to have concerning our salvation?
I try to do as best as I can. Of course, I got the question a bit late. The question, I'll go over it again, what confidence can we have in Christ's triumph over Satan as it relates to our salvation? First, because of Jesus' sacrifice on Calvary's tree, salvation is available to all, which means deliverance, perseverance, and victory is assured to all if we accept Jesus as our Savior from sin. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, at Calvary, through his death, his burial, and his resurrection, deliverance, the victory to overcome sin and temptation was made available to us all. Also, we find in the name of Jesus, we have dunamis, power, might, strength to be victorious. Power, authority through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, overcoming power, not by might nor by power, but by God's Spirit. Not through our own strength, by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We find that literally because of the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we saints we have the power to overcome and become victorious. And this victory was obtained at Calvary. That's the reason why, as saints, we need to have an intimate connection with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, not now and again, but always. And we make this connection through the study of His holy word, through prayer, through meditation on His holy word, recognizing that the word of God is more necessary than our food, especially in the times in which we are living in. Jesus made all of this available, power to overcome sin, because we are living in a world, when I look at what's happening, I'm coming up to 91 and I've seen lots of things. I have heard the old saints talking about things to come, but brothers and sisters, not things to come, we are in it. And as the Apostle Paul says, I can do all things through Christ that strengtheneth me. So I will encourage saints to study God's word, to pray, and as my brother Keith Davidson said, be loving and kind to everyone. I don't know about you, but when you do a kind act, people ask you, do we have people like this around still? I don't know. This is what they're saying. The world is becoming very fierce, and we are saints. We have got to demonstrate the love of Jesus Christ as is revealed to us through His death, His burial, His resurrection, and His soon coming. So may the Lord bless us that we will accept these words of encouragement and truth and apply them to our lives in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus' victory. Accepting Jesus' victory. So throughout the narrative of the Bible, we see that Jesus defeated Satan at various points in his existence. Satan tried to take him out when he was just a baby, and that didn't work. He tried to finesse him and ingratiate him with things that we need as a human being in the temptation in the wilderness, and that didn't work. Jesus even beat him in death. You'd have thought he would have given up at that point. And so what does that tell us? I mean, are we sort of bystanders sort of cheering Jesus on like, yes, Jesus, you made it? Or what part do we have in all of this? Surely, we had, I don't know if you've ever read what the promises are given to the churches, the seven churches, by overcoming. That suggests that there's something that they, a part that they had to play in it. And maybe I'll just indulge us for a little bit. If someone would want to quickly find Revelation 2, verse 7, and hold the same page and read verse 11 and 17 as well. If, very quickly, if someone doesn't mind doing that. Revelation 2, verse 7.
Revelation 2, verse 7.
Yes.
He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God.
Okay. And verse 11, please.
Verse 11. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death.
Thank you. And if I could indulge you for one more, verse 17.
17, okay. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it.
Thank you, Elder. And what you'll find that there's a recurring pattern, because the same is said of the other churches throughout the ages. So for the entire length of the church's existence, we are called to overcome. So that's not just for now, that's for all time. And I would say none of us here at present today would wanted to endure what the folks back in the Dark Ages had to endure. I think I'm tough, but I don't think I'm be able to go through all of that. Edwin. And finally, in Revelation 21, verse 7, if someone would doesn't mind.
He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son.
Thank you so much. So that sums it up. The overcoming, it comes with reward. Are we prepared to do what it takes or accept our position in doing that? And so I will ask for Sister Pilgrim, Pat Pilgrim, to read Revelation 12, verse 10 to 11, please, before we take our question over to Elder Anel.
From the New King James Version, then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come, for the accuser of our brethren who accused them before our God day and night has been cast down, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death.
Amen. And so the question to Elder Smith is, how might we find encouragement from these scriptures, and which elements are central to the process of overcoming?
Thank you. Good morning. Happy Sabbath, everyone. How might we find encouragement? Well, yes, we're dealing with an enemy, but the enemy, as the scripture tells us, is a defeated enemy. I believe also in Luke we hear Jesus saying, I saw Satan cast down from heaven like lightning. So he's already defeated. Some of you maybe remember seeing some of those old Western films that had John Wayne and such individuals, and you might see somebody who's been fatally wounded, they're going to die, but even while they're on the ground dying, if they can reach a gun, they're still shooting. And that's where I would put Satan. His death sentence is already upon him, it's game over, but as he's going out, he's trying to see who he can take out with him. So the good news is he's defeated. The good news is that in Christ, we can overcome him as an enemy, but recognize he still poses a threat, and without Christ, we're at risk. What elements can we draw strength from? Well, we've been told in Revelation 12, verse 11, that they overcame. I want us to understand that's actually a piece of prophecy, because it's telling us that there are God's church people who did overcome. And how did they overcome? By God's grace. How will we overcome? By the blood of the Lamb, that's accepting the sacrifice of Jesus, and by the word of their testimony. What is the word of our testimony? It's our confession of who God is. It's our experience of what he has done. And obviously, we confess, we become ambassadors because we believe what Jesus has said. We believe he is who he said he is. I'm finally going to leave you with a scripture in Ephesians chapter 1 and then also in 2. And it says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name, I add in, including Satan, that is named not only in this world, but in that which is to come. In Ephesians 2, verse 6, it tells us, and have raised us up together and made us sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So we have victory.
Sorry, Elder, I thought you were poised for to give a comment, but never mind. Okay, no problem. Anyone want to add or build on?
Yeah,
just quickly in that text, after, you know, by the word of their testimony, it says, and they did not love their lives to the death. You know, we look back at the believers of old, you know, and they gave their lives, their blood was shed in the most cruelest of ways. And even today, many are giving their lives for Christ. And we have to be willing in this day and age, in our church and so on, to be willing to give up our lives for Christ because he gave his life for us.
Amen. Amen. Okay. Moving on to Wednesdays. The woman in the wilderness. And before we go further, is this Sister Sabanda Kenyon here? Okay, thank you. I'd ask you to read Revelation 12, verse 6. And then 14 to 16, please.
Verse 6.
Yes.
And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Mm. Verses 14 to 16. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time, and times and half a time, from the face of the serpent. Mm. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood. Mm. And the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth.
Thank you so much. My one regret is I don't have any illustrations or visual aids, because I think that would have really aided what we're trying to do. But going forward, I'm probably going to suggest that we do that, because it helps to, well, for myself anyway, helps us to capture what we're trying to discuss. So the woman in the wilderness, so we have more imagery, more symbols, which I'm going to ask us to expound on. But we're looking at the period of time, very difficult period of time. The 260 days, which we interpret as literal years, from the time of 538 AD to 1798, which is a significant period of time. And I'll suggest to us, which I know most of us may already know, this was the time when Imperial Rome became Papal Rome, and under the Emperor Justinian in 538, what happened was they realized that in order to because they knew they couldn't stop Christianity, what was his name? Constantine. They knew that they said to themselves, if we can't beat them, let us join them, and when we join them, then we will bring in our own ideas. But specifically under the Emperor Justinian in 538, what happened is that they started to bring in persecution for Sabbath observance. So they were having feast days and whatnot on Sundays, parallel to observance on Sabbath. But it so happened that they wanted to do away with the Sabbath and then keep solely just Sunday. And that began. And from that time right down until Pope Pius VI in 1798, there were 1,260 days and 190 popes from 538 till 1798. The Pope, incidentally, was removed by Napoleon Bonaparte, and as I mentioned earlier, but under Napoleon, yes. But I did suggest earlier that it was an enslaved man who overcame Napoleon. I'll let that hang for a minute. Yeah, but anyway, so let us get a bit more into this. So the church in the wilderness. Who is the church in the wilderness? And Oh, sorry, I was supposed to come to another. I'm really losing the plot today. Okay, let me just go straight to Anel. So, Anel, did I ask you the question already?
No, you did.
I did, yeah, sorry, let me.
Okay,
fine, yes, okay. So we'll let Anel come in. So Anel would very ably tell us what this all means.
Thank you. One thing, I seem to remember reading about this situation with the woman in the wilderness and the dragon sending out the water and the earth swallowing up that. I seem to remember this being representative of the role that America played at that time to actually help the church. The lesson didn't speak about it on this occasion, which I thought would have been helpful because I find it's good to reinforce.
Of course.
Because we forget. I can't say I've got an extensive amount of knowledge and can give you all the history, but I'm sure it was the role that America played in enabling the Protestant movement to rise and enabling people to have more freedom with respect to faith and not stay under the tyranny of what the Roman church was doing. If anyone is positioned to elaborate on that, I just think it would be helpful for all of us.
Okay.
But I seem to remember that being the significance of the flood and the earth being America that enabled that situation that was supposed to drown God's church not succeeding.
Yes. Well, The Americas, which was it was a young nation, it was just becoming a nation at the time. Somebody wants to say something? Sister Esther?
Last night when I was watching it is written, the man on that platform was asking the very Pastor Finley who wrote the lesson because he has a program that has already gone forth, aired on the 3ABN. And he was asking why he started on chapter 12 instead of chapter 14, where the three angels' messages were written. Then this is like people say preamble, something that leads to that. The particular explanation of how America was a heaven for the people fleeing from persecution is later in the program. So they didn't want to just jump into it because these are leading to what you are talking about. They know that the woman is the church.
Yes.
And the place that was prepared for her was over there in the Americas. But then the son that was caught up into heaven is Jesus because Satan couldn't kill him. So when Jesus resurrected, Jesus is today at the right hand of God and he's ministering, interceding for us. So those ones are coming in the future lessons according to what he said.
Thank you. I'm just going back to what Elder Anel was saying a bit earlier, and the role of America. So we know from about the 1600s, around 1620, Puritans, or the ones who were the ones who believed that they were keeping the statutes as given by the Bible, they were under heavy persecution by Rome. And America was a welcoming door for them to go and practice. So from about the 1600s, going all the way through to the 1790s, people were coming to America. And then even into the 20th century, America seems to be a place where people seeking refuge from around the world go to seek a new start, better conditions, and the freedom to practice according to the dictates of their conscience. America became a nation around 1776, I believe. So it's just shortly before all of this took place. So America certainly does have a role and is having a role towards the end as well, which we'll go into at another time. Unfortunately, I'll have to let Anel come back in because it is her question. But it's just that the time doesn't allow us to really going under the layers. So I'll just go back to Nelinda and let her finish what she was saying, or start.
Sorry, what was my question?
Your question.
Because I didn't think I had one, but I just wanted to share that.
Sorry. Oh, okay.
I just wanted to share that point, but as Brother Hezron is just leading us to where we go next, isn't it interesting to see how God uses who and what he will for his purposes? Because we see America in this situation as being an aid for the cause of the gospel, but actually later on, it takes an opposite position of becoming now a threat with in terms of the role of the false prophet and what we will now see. Again, the Protestant movement again, which at one point seemed to give an opportunity for that religious freedom, is now going to become a force for oppression. So it's so interesting. And this is why we can't put our trust in princes and kings. We just have to follow the Lamb wheresoever he goeth, because he will the Holy Spirit is the one who guides us into all truth. So I don't know if there were any questions.
Sorry, no. Again, I'm all over the place this morning.
No,
so your question was asked and you dealt with it. That's fine. So we'll go swiftly to Thursday. And for Thursday, we will have Sister De Silva. If she could read Revelation 12, verse 17, please.
A memory verse, and I bet everybody know this one. Revelation 12, 17. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And I think this is a wonderful text to commit to memory.
Okay. All right. So this is an open question. Actually, there was a question on Wednesday, but it can also go with Thursdays as well. And this is open to anybody who wants to take it. And it's this. It's briefly explain a difficult or trying experience where God came through for you in an unexpected way. Hang on, okay. In the context of the great controversy.
Yes, the dragon wrought with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, who keep the commandment of God and have the testimony of Jesus. Well, as we know that the woman is the church and Christ's church. God only have one church. Mm-hmm. He only have one wife. I come into it, and the dragon, which started his war in heaven, and this coming down now to the end of time, when as we notice the religious freedom, as we see it already, it start to dry up. We could last time when we spread a big tent, and we can't do it anymore. We used to do that every year. And we noticed, I can remember Denise tell me before she stopped work that she used to put up little things on our workplace and our Bible and the desk. Now they say to her, look, you can't do that. Put it in a jar. We don't want to see it. And we see our religious freedom is being eroded over the years more and more. And we noticed that people, I was just listening on the Adventist radio where they were doing the lesson where it was talking about so much of our freedom is taken away from us religiously. We need to know that we are at the end of time, and it must be affect us in whatsoever we do in our business, in our workplace, wherever we go. Children of God, we will realize our religious freedom is eroded. Can't we see that we are at the end of time? And the end of time where the dragon will show more expression of his evil against God's people, it will affect us from time to time, so we better prepare.
Amen. Thank you, Elder. And so I guess the pertinent question is, where is our allegiance? I think what I was really trying to get at was the fact that every decision that we make, everything that we do is conducive to what side of the fence, as it were, we are going to be on. There is no demilitarized zone. We're either on one side or we are on the other. And the question is, where are we? We do believe we are the remnant, do we not? Are we convinced that we are the remnant, or that we are living in literally the very last times? Elder Davidson and Anna.
I don't know if she's finished. I'll wait.
Anna, if you wanna, thank you.
I just wanted to say that the remnant church is defined in Scripture as those who keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So once we fall within that definition, we are a part of God's remnant people. What I encourage us not to do is try to define the remnant by ourselves.
Sure.
That's important. It's by the Bible, and once we fall within the definition, we are those people.
Thank you. Elder Davidson.
Yet. I think if I understand your question, you're asking us to bring some personal application to to what we've studied today.
Yes.
And I think that's quite an important question. Because oftentimes, even in this church here, we go by theory and not practice. And I may have said this before, but pardon me if I have to repeat it, but it's for firstly my learning and all learning together. We've got to try to practice what we preach and what we know. Because some of us here, there was a time when, you know, I was isolated and one or two others by God's people. Because I seem to believe in, some of you know that I believe in Micah 6 verse 8, be a champion for the cause of justice and have a heart of compassion, but be humble.
Of course.
So we've got to watch ourselves, because but for the grace of God, I would just still dislike some people here because of the way some of us were isolated. And pushed out, and there was a time when I wasn't even asked to serve as an elder. So we got to watch ourselves. By the grace of God, I want to be obedient to His laws. I want to still be a champion of the cause of justice and have that heart of compassion. Let us preach. Let us practice what we preach.
Thank you, Elder, for that very candid response. Okay, we can entertain a few more. I think it's Sister Safina at the back. And third. Okay, all right. Sister Safina? Yeah, we'll come to you.
Thank you. We really have to be very careful, because when Christ, the time he was born, people were in synagogue and they were expecting the Messiah to come. When he came, did they knew that he was there? They didn't, but they were children, God's people. And what are we also have to reflect on is to see, are we ready in case if we are called that we are remnants, we are the chosen generation, are we really practicing what is being told, or we are just putting the name on our face? We have to be very careful.
Amen. Thank you. Sister Sobers and Ben Adel, please. Sister.
Oh. Okay. All right, that's fine. I think we can accommodate that. Yes, please. No, it's okay. Go ahead.
Okay. So sorry. In Revelation 19, verse 10 says, "And I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said unto me, See, thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren, and of the testimony of Jesus, worship God. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy, and as we know it, that our church hath the spirit of prophecy, and we should abide by it."
Thank you. Elder Smith, Senior.
Yeah, and my thought, thank you for allowing me, but my thought on this is, and the emphasis should be, why is it Satan is after those who keep the commandment of God and have the faith of Jesus? You see, we are in a society now where there's a lot of other denominations that are talking about it's not necessary to keep the commandments because Jesus has kept it for you and so forth. We have to be certain whether we are in the faith or not. And if we are in the faith, we need to be concerned as well, we are all older people here, of the younger people, because quite likely, not necessarily so, that we older ones who are steadfast in the faith, I hope all of us are, that we might pass on. But then the younger generation will have the brunt of it. And if they're not settled in the understanding of what we believe and in the understanding of the scripture and so on, the church is going to be in a very, very serious state. Yeah.
Okay, we'll go to Anel, please. It's okay.
Well, the church is in a serious state. What we know is that God's church will survive. His word has told us. The issue is, will we be a part of it? And that's what we're laboring. We're laboring to see God's church have as many individuals having the opportunity to come in and stay in as possible. But I just wanted to give another sobering word. I really appreciate the points that you made, Elder Davidson, Dad Davidson as well. It's good for us to have these moments of reflection. But you know what's awesome? That whole rough scenario we went through, and there will be other rough scenarios, when you're able to come through them and the brethren are able to come together again, isn't it a hallelujah moment? Isn't it a testament to the fact that broken though we are, making mistakes though we are, we do have a heart for God. There is love amongst us and God is working with us, because I'm telling you, that situation could have left us in total tatters. And when you can see that we can come together and be family and serve again, it tells you how good it is for us to hold on to God. And so there is no situation before us that we can't overcome when we allow God to work with us. There are situations like that that could want to brew up again. It's our indicator that sometimes things are not always as they seem. So as we hold on to God, as we hold on to his principles, as we surrender, God's church will triumph. We will triumph. Amen.
Amen. And I read someone who read a little earlier about coming back to overcoming. The messages that the Lord has for the churches. Revelation 3, verse 21. Would someone just like to read Revelation 3:21, please?
Put your hand up if you found it. To him that overcometh, I will grant him to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and I am set down with my Father in his throne.
Amen. And that's for us this time. And so with all of the everything, we've discussed some weighty matters, we've alluded to some, time will not allow us to go into deeper depth, but I think we've taken away enough for now. But we know that we can be encouraged.
Why? Because Christ has done all the heavy lifting for us already. And in that we can not only be spectators of his victory, but we can claim the victory as it be ours. And so let us be encouraged. Many of you, the folks here, you're older than I am, and you've been in this way for a long time. It would be a tragedy to give up at this point, and for all the efforts that have been made to lose out on the kingdom. As a younger as a relatively younger person compared to most of you here, I have had the benefit of being able to benefit from the teachings from most of you, whether it be direct or passive or indirect. And there is a passion for the younger people who seem to have challenges that we did not have. And I'd ask that we would give special prayer and attention to them. But let us be encouraged, because we can do this because Christ has done it for us. Let us exercise our free will. As Moses said to the Israel shortly before they crossed over into Jordan in, I think it was Deuteronomy chapter 30. He's saying, heaven and earth are witness against us. Right? Life and death is presented before us. Let us choose life because we can. Okay, that's what I will say to us. And if we don't get this opportunity to gather together again, let us ponder deeply on these words. I have to apologize because I have a lot on my mind at the moment, and that has affected my delivery. Yes, but I'm glad we have this opportunity to come and learn together. Let us encourage another member so that we would come to Sabbath School, more people would join, not only online, but to come in person and fellowship and strengthen each other. Thank you for your participation. Okay. All right, so I'll just pray this time. Thank you, dear Lord, for bringing us together like this. These words are serious and exciting at the same time. Dear Lord, you have, in your mercy, you have given us a snippet of the future and how it will all end. And we are assured of victory because you have done it already for us. Let us accept it. You've given us free choice. Let us choose life. I pray for all the brethren here. I pray for every single person alive who has passed through these doors. I pray that you will impress upon them to seek to work out their salvation. In Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen.
Thank you very much, Brother Hezron, for that lesson study, and thank you, all of you who participated. We are now going to have a look at our mission story, but before we have a look at the mission story, I will say a prayer, so, and then the deacons will collect while the mission story is being shown. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this another opportunity to give, Lord, to promote your work, to help your work to go further and further into the mission field. I pray that you may bless what is going to be given, and may we too have hearts for mission, I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
In 1864, the first Adventist to set foot on European soil was the unofficial missionary, Michael B. Chakowski. Europe was the first continent after North America where Seventh-day Adventists began missionary work. In 1864, the first Adventist to set foot on European soil was the unofficial missionary, Michael B. Chakowski. He first worked in the Waldensian Valleys in northern Italy and later in Switzerland, where in 1867, he founded the first Adventist church outside North America in Tromelon. In 1874, John Nevins Andrews, the first official Adventist missionary, arrived in Switzerland to continue the work of Joukowsky. Today, Switzerland is part of the inter-European division of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. This territory includes 20 countries with almost 200,000 Adventists. There are Adventist publishing houses, schools, media centers, hospitals, and other institutions within this region. In Gland, Switzerland, an Adventist summer camp called La Plage has operated seasonally for years. This camp has been instrumental in changing the spiritual lives of Swiss young people. Arnaud came as a camper when he was a kid. The influence of this camp inspired him to live a life of service.
I left Switzerland to be a volunteer in Egypt, in Nile Union Academy, and I spent the year teaching English and taking care of the kids. I can say without any hesitation that last year changed my life, because I came back with the wish of studying theology, and I am now a student in theology that I would have never thought about doing that before.
Arnaud acknowledges that the spiritual environment and support during his younger years at La Plage were foundational in his later decision to serve in Egypt. Because of those positive experiences as a camper, he has come back as a camp leader over the past few summers.
So I think this place led me to many other activities and opportunities that led me to be a volunteer. Meeting the people that I met here and living those amazing experiences were the thing that motivated me to continue. I remember with friends we used to make jokes on the videos that we were making for like a kind of recap every day. And we were making many jokes, and seeing this after many years after still brings me a smile. And I think the people that I met here and the camps, the activities, everything motivated me a lot.
The camp is limited by its facilities. It can only operate in the warmer months due to the piping and plumbing. In the colder months, the pipes freeze, making the kitchen and bathroom areas unusable. Another limitation is the kitchen. This small space needs an update with an area for proper food storage, a better layout, and new appliances. With these improvements, the camp would be able to operate year-round, opening new opportunities to serve.
There's one thing that I realized when I was in Egypt and when I came back, is that Switzerland doesn't have many volunteers around the world. This place could become a center of formation, a center to help people find their vocation in the service, in the mission, in Switzerland or outside Switzerland. But I know that in the churches here, we have many young people that don't know really what they want to do with their life. And having a place like this, with trainings, with help, with pastors here to help them, would be a great chance for them to understand what they want to do with their life. And I can take me as an example. I never thought I would study theology before. My purpose is defined. This place could become a great, great chance for young people and member of the church or outside of the church to understand the mission and the purpose that Christ is asking us to follow.
This quarter, a portion of your 13th Sabbath offering will go to the renovations of La Plage. Your contribution will allow more programs to occur year-round and expand to more age groups. Please pray for this project in Switzerland. Thank you for your support of the offering that makes a difference in the lives of people like Arnaud.
Amen. In closing our Sabbath school this morning, remember this morning our little, just a little discussion, and I just want to pull out one line from what I've said this morning. And it says, seeking God's plan, not his blessing for your plan. And that's something that we are going to be focusing on today. Seeking the Lord's plan about this building and not our plan. And we need faith and trust and trusting God. And there's a little reading here from Education, the book Education, which says, faith is trusting God, believing that he loves us and knows best what is for our good. Thus, instead of our own, it leads us to choose his way. In place of our ignorance, it accepts his wisdom. In place of our weakness, his strength. In place of our sinfulness, his righteousness. Our lives, ourselves, are already his. Faith acknowledges his ownership and accepts its blessing. Truth, uprightness, purity have been pointed out as secrets of life's success. It is faith that puts us in possession of these principles. May God have the richest blessing to us this morning as we contemplate these words. And as we continue to the other part of the service, may we keep an attitude of prayer. And remember, we are praying about this building. We are going to have our closing hymn number 528. After which, Sister Tomlinson is going to close us in prayer. Thank you. 528. I will stand and sing.
Shall we sing together? It's a lovely hymn. Let us just give God the praise that he deserves.
Which one?
Hymn number 528. The Lord's our rock, in him we hide, a shelter in a time of storm. Shall we sing?
The Lord's our rock, in him we hide, a shelter in the time of storm. Secure whatever may betide, a shelter in the time of storm. Mighty rock in a weary land, cooling shade. Shade by day, defense by night, a shelter in the time of storm. No fears alarm, no foes affright, a shelter in the time of storm. Mighty rock. Shelter in the time of storm. The raging floods may round us beat, a shelter in the time of storm. We find in God a safe retreat, a shelter in the time of storm.
Mighty rock.
Mighty rock in a weary land, cooling shade from the burning sand. Faithful guide for the pilgrim band, a shelter in the time of storm.
Last verse.
Oh, rock divine, oh, refuge dear, shelter in the time of storm. Be thou our helper ever near, a shelter in the time of storm. My
Shall we bow our heads for prayers? Our kind and ever-loving Father, we thank you for waking us up this morning and bringing us here safely. Lord, as we approach your throne of mercy, we ask, dear Lord, that you be with us and take our minds, Lord, from the care of this world, where peace and grace abound. Oh, loving Father, we want to love you more, we want to serve you more. Lord, so please come into our hearts now and bless us as we lift our thoughts to you. And help us, dear Lord, only to think about the things that is important, Lord, and that is our soul. We ask that you guide us and protect us, Lord, into all truth. And Lord, while we enter into the other portion of worship, we ask you to dismiss us from this part, O Lord, we pray thee. And help us, Lord, that we may give listening ears to the rest of your word today. Guide the minds and the thoughts and the words of those who have to present it to you, dear Lord. Give them the authority and the clarity, dear Lord, to speak as you commanded them. So bless each and every one is here. Help those who are on their way, dear Lord, that their feet may be hastened, and they will get here in time to hear your words. So thank you, loving Father, for blessing us this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Sabbath school is now adjourned.
That you're wonderful, but it doesn't seem good enough. I can say that you're kind, but that would miss the mark. I can say that you're beautiful, but to me you are so much more. How do I communicate exactly who trying to convey the sentiment of my heart and say I really do appreciate the way you brighten up my day.
I can't find the words to describe you.
It would take a million years.
It would take a million years to explain.
Down the line and name all the things that captivate my heart, but clearly I'm not aware of words that can compare. How do I communicate exactly who you are? I'm trying to my heart and say I really do appreciate.
transitions all in my way. But still I'm onward bound each and every day. No matter what, I'll continue to run.
Bringing you SEC News in 60 seconds. Stanborough Park Church member. Enoch Kanagaraj was honoured as a community champion by the Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, at an event held at 10 Downing Street last Thursday. Kanagaraj was nominated by Watford MP Dean Russell for his work supporting vulnerable individuals and families as founder and CEO of One Vision, the charity started at Stanborough Park Church. Last Sabbath, several SEC congregations held special programs for the BUC-wide Education Day. Ilford Central Church invited Stanborough Secondary School, including Pupils, head teacher Janetta Liebert, and chaplain Ray Patrick to lead its worship service. Last Sunday, Tottenham Lighthouse Church held its first Community Day of 2023. Its Sharing the Love event offered visitors free services including health checks, legal and careers advice, massage, religious literature and refreshments. Thanks for watching. See you next week. Click the like button and subscribe to our channel to get the latest videos from the SEC.
Long time,
let's have a
find yourself at times when it seems like everybody's falling off, God never will.
Morning, church. Good morning, church. Is it a blessing to be in the house of the Lord? Even though it might feel a bit chilly. A bit chilly? Praise God anyhow, yeah? So I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing this song, Surely the Presence of the Lord is in this place. That should get you warm, isn't it?
Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. You are worthy, O Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. Great and marvelous are your deeds, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, King of the ages. Who will not fear you, O Lord, and bring glory to your name? For you alone are holy, holy. All nations will come and worship before you, and your righteous acts have been revealed. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. May we bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we invite your presence to be here with us this morning. Father, Lord, I pray that you may bless every head, Lord, bowed in your presence. Help us, Lord, that we will have an open heart, Lord, ready to receive from you a special blessing. We just want to give you praise and glory and honor because you are worthy. Thank you, Lord, for being with us here this morning. In Jesus' name I've prayed. Amen. Amen.
Please be standing. We're going to be singing our opening song, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less Than Jesus' Blood and Righteousness. As we're this morning, we're focusing on praying for our building project. We believe that this church is built upon Christ, a solid rock. So my hope is built in nothingness. Oh, sorry. Higher ground. Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood.
trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seemed to veil his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant and blood, support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
You may be seated. Thank you.
Once again, I would like to say good morning and happy Sabbath to everyone. At this time, I just want to welcome you to God's house. There are people here that I'm seeing for the first time, and there are other friends who I have seen a few times. So our welcome, I just want to say a special welcome to all of our first time. Can you visit us? Can you just wave your hand to us, those of you who have been here for the first time? Okay. I want to also welcome those of you who are here every Sabbath, regular members of the Holloway Seventh-day Adventist Church. I just want to welcome you, and I hope that each of you had a wonderful week. I want to also extend my welcome to those at home. We have regular people who are viewing us every week, and I just want to say hello to you, all of you who are viewing us every week. And if you're a first-time viewer, please, I hope today you too will be happy to join us and that you will join us at other times. So at this time, before we do anything else, let us greet each other in Jesus' name. So I'm going to just ask you to stand. If there's a visitor beside you, please greet that visitor, or a friend, doesn't matter. Let us greet each other in Jesus' name at this time. Let us all stand.
Let us greet somebody in Jesus' name. Let us tell them that we love them in Jesus' name. Let us, we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile, Jesus loves you. Everybody smile, Jesus loves you. Let's greet somebody. Let us tell them that we love them in Jesus' name. Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile, Jesus loves you. Everybody smile, Jesus loves you.
Okay, thank you very much. You may be seated. And I hope that you will have be blessed today as we hear and participate in this service at this time. Thank you very much.
Sabbath blessings to you all. This is a wonderful time in our service. It's a time when we're going to talk to God, where we're going to ask him to draw near to us, and we're going to ask him to actually guide us in prayer. Now, prayer is not something passive, so I want to encourage you that every single one of us here, God wants to hear from. And the fact that you're in church today says that God is calling you. Now, sometimes we feel that because maybe we haven't spoken to God for a while, or because we know our lives don't measure up, that we shouldn't talk to God. Big mistake. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to have a couple minutes. First of all, a minute of silent prayer where you can just say, "Hello, God, I give you honor. It's me. I really want to spend time with you today. Please prepare me." After you've done your 1 minute by yourself, I want you to find a partner. In fact, find the partner. And when you get your partner, spend that 1 minute of just you talking to God. And then I'm going to ask that you pray. You pray for us as a church. When we say pray for us as a church, we're asking you to pray about us as individuals, our hearts. We're asking you to pray for the mission of the church, what we're here for, that God would use us. And we're asking you, we're having a special emphasis today on the church building. Have a look up, everyone. Have a look up at the ceiling. Do you like what you see? No. So we're going to talk to God about those things. Is God able?
Indeed.
So please, if where possible, if you could go now and find a partner. And when you get to your partner, you're going to start with just a moment of silent prayer. If you feel shy to find a partner, just wave and somebody will come and find you. All right. Good, good. Everybody find a partner. And the first minute is in silent prayer where you're saying, "God, it's me. Please make me worthy to talk to you." And then you're going to pray for the church.
Gracious, eternal, awesome, wonderful God, we come through your Son Jesus. Father, I pray that me who stand before your people, your congregation, in the presence of your people, in your presence, Lord, that you will forgive me. Forgive me, Lord, where I have sinned and done wrong against you, Lord. I pray this, our Lord, that you will cleanse me, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted in your sight. Father, Lord, this is your people. You have known all the way, the church, as we call it. This is the building, Lord. We come on behalf, Lord. Father, we want to put this building before you now, Lord. Gracious God, so many things we have seen that you have done. And I know, Lord, without any doubt, the way you are in my life, that you are still alive and the things, nothing is impossible to you where you're concerned, Lord. So, Father, this is the building, Lord. The desire of your people for a place where we can come together, Lord, and worship you. Father, we are asking for your intervention, Lord, for the miracle, Lord, that we are longing to see with this building, Lord. And we come, oh God, today, this morning. seal and we're sealing papers, the leakage, everything. Now we're even working and decentralizing. Lord, we know, Lord, that this is your building, your church. And we ask, Lord, that you will step in, oh God, and do for us what we can't do, Lord. All the things, Lord, that we are asking for, Lord, if you see fit, I pray that you'll grant unto us, oh God. Father, that this will be your place, that men will come and they'll hear the testimony of your saints about the miracle that you have done and what you have made this place to be, oh God. Our finances, Lord, we put that before you. Lord, there is nothing in this world that doesn't belong to you. There is nothing in this world that you cannot do. And we ask, oh God, that our finances, jobs, how we spend, the responsibilities that have been placed upon us, Lord, that we need to do. I pray, Lord, that you will speak to our hearts, Lord, and that every individual will examine themselves, Lord, and do, Lord, according to your scripture and your word, I pray today. Bless us now, Lord, I pray. And remember our men in this church, Lord.
Hold a bit, please, because we're going to have to pray openly.
Yes. Okay.
I'm sorry for this.
No, that's fine.
Tis the precious hour of prayer, when our hearts slowly bend, and we gather to Jesus, our Savior and friend. With a simple, come to him in faith, his protection to share.
What a balm.
What a balm for the weary. Oh, how sweet to be there. Blessed hour of prayer. Blessed hour of prayer. What a balm for sweet to be there.
Let us continue in prayer. Great God Almighty, Jehovah, we say hallelujah to your great and matchless name. We thank you, God, for the strength, for the sobriety to be able to come into your house. And we're here today to give you worship. Oh God, like David, like Solomon, like Nehemiah, we have a burden on our heart, Lord, to see us as a people truly give you glory at all ages, from the youngest to the oldest, Lord. We want to be honorable before you. We want to be pleasing in your sight. But Lord, not just us, not just our hearts, not just the things we do in your name, but Lord, also this space. We want this church, oh God, to demonstrate that we think highly of you, to demonstrate, Lord, in a small human way, that you are awesome, that you are great, that you are worthy to be praised. We want this church building to show that we value the privilege of being the people called by your name. And so, Father God, that when people come into this space, even, Lord, when you allow your presence to be with us, you will know that in every way we can, we are honoring you. And so, God, as a congregation, we've been praying that you would forgive our sins. Today, we are saying thank you for the righteousness of Christ. We accept your righteousness. We bless you for this righteousness. And, dear God, we are asking you to guide us in prayer. Please, Holy Spirit, help us to pray. Dear Lord, we've seen that sometimes we make mistakes. We've seen that our understanding can be skewed, but your word tells us that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and that if we ask of you, you will show us great and mighty things that we do not know. And so today, O God, as we put before you the moving forward of this church, as we put before you the hopes regarding the church building, dear Lord, we want to take a moment to say, should in case we have got it wrong, should in case that we didn't consult you enough, and in fact we believe we have not consulted enough, dear Lord, would you speak to us? We're asking for wisdom, and we believe you will give it liberally. Dear Lord, what do you want us to do with this building? What services do you yet want us to offer from this place? Dear Lord, what levels should there be? Where should there be a hall? Where should we locate conveniences? What size, Lord? Because when you were telling your people to build your sanctuary, you were very specific. You even confirmed colors. And we know, Father God, that you have all wisdom. So we're asking you even now to inspire afresh our pastors, our planning team, our board, our church membership, and our business meetings. Dear Lord, would you lead in the plans with regards to the architects, Father God, and any project manager that would be selected? We are asking you, O God, to be the inspiration. Dear Lord, we know that you even spoke to a donkey. We know, Lord, that when the wise men went to see Jesus and Herod had said, come back and tell me where he is, through a dream you inspired them not to go. And so we're asking you, God, to inspire all people concerning the moving forward of your church mission and building, and let us be conformed and surrendered to you. Because, Lord, we know that except you build the house, we labor in vain. Father God, we repent of money that's being wasted, but we want to thank you, God, that you said you will restore what the cankerworm has stolen. And so, Father, you know through disputes and conflict and confusion, much has been lost, but in your mercy, God, we know that you give other chances, and we're saying, please, God, work with us again. Show your plan, Lord, and give us the strength to implement according to your will. And dear Lord, we're asking for a building that is beyond the building. We're asking that you will rebuild us as a people. You will rebuild us in worship. You will rebuild us in your word. You will rebuild us in holiness, so that everything in this place will glorify your name. And so that those who come here, Lord, as many do even during the week, to seek your face, to pray to you, that because this space will be so dedicated to you, Lord, that you will honor the prayers offered, that you will honor the service offered. And Father God, when people are fed in this place, they will be well fed. And when they're supported, they will be well supported. Thank you, God, for filling this place and your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us continue to pray. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege is it to carry everything to God in prayer. Gracious, eternal, almighty, wonderful God, we come, Lord, not because we're good, but because we're human. Father, we're sinful, we're disobedient, and at one time you even describe us as stiff necks. Lord, but we're here because we love you. And we come, Lord, because we believe in you. We want to worship you, Lord. And we gather here today. Nothing in our hands we bring, Lord, but to your cross we cling. Holy Father, take the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, and let it be acceptable to you, O God, because I come on behalf of your people. I'm not worthy, Lord, but you are. The word I speak may come from my mouth, but they are your word, Lord. And you told us that your word's got life and it's got power. Father, you commanded dry bones, Lord, to become live, and it happened. So we believe in you, Lord. And here we are, Lord, come, Lord, speaking to you about the building that we come to worship you, Lord. You've seen the condition, Lord. And many times we pray, Lord, but we want to make this prayer different from all the other times, Lord, that we have prayed to you. Because we know that the Lord we serve are hearing us, Lord. My life is an example. The moment and the minute I'm standing here, Lord, I know that you are holy God and that you answer prayer. So, Father, we come this hour, this building, Lord, we present it before you, Lord. You've seen the plan. You've known the desire of the people, Lord. And I'm asking you, Lord, to intervene like you've never intervened before, Lord. Father, we're asking, Lord, to show us another miracle, Lord, with what you're going to do to this place, Lord. Let your will be done, I pray, Lord. And let us, Lord, accept whatever you do, Lord, whatever you say, Lord, we will go and we will do. Father, I pray, Lord, for our finances. You've given us health. You've given us jobs. The money that we earn, Lord, we're only custodians of it, Lord. Let us spend it wisely, Lord, as you continue to bless us. Father, let us go and share whatever that you give us, Lord, let us give. We want to thank you today, Lord, that again, Lord, this is prayer and this is fasting and prayer service, Lord. And we come specifically, Lord, with different things that we want to ask you about, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that in every single one of us that gather here today, Lord, you know our hearts and you can see. And I put every single one, even those online, Lord, I pray for them. I put them before you, Lord. The men of Holloway Church, Lord, they're time for us to rise and for us to stand, Lord, and be counted, Lord. And I pray, Holy God, that you will take control. Bless us now, Lord, we ask all these in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
At this time, we'd like us all to prepare to return our gifts to the Lord. But just before I read you a few verses from Proverbs chapter 11, I would just like to make an appeal to all the men of Holloway Church that immediately after the divine service, all men of Holloway Church, immediately after divine service, we'd like to meet you at the front here. Okay, thank you. Proverbs chapter 11, and I'm going to read from verse 23. It says, "The desire of the righteous is only good, but the expectation of the wicked is wrath. There is that scattereth and yet increaseth. And there is that withholdeth more than his meat, but it tendeth to poverty. The liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that watereth shall be watered also himself. He that withholdeth corn, the people shall curse him, but blessing shall be upon the head of him that selleth it." What you want today? A blessing or a curse? The Bible says that if you withhold your corn, the people will curse you. It means simply that what God has given us, what God has enabled us to have, we should be able to share for the benefit of others around. And the Lord says to us that if we withhold our tithes or our offering according to Malachi chapter 3, then we would be cursed with a curse. A curse is something that none of us want. So I trust that by God's grace, we would faithfully give to him what belongs to him. And at the same time, as we see the needs of others, we would be willing to give also so that we would not receive curse from them. So this morning, as we prepare, let us bow our heads and thank the Lord for the gifts that we would be returning. Loving Father, we give you thanks that you have enabled us to have health, strength, intellect, and everything else that you have provided for us. Lord, may you help that we may use them wisely, so that not only from you, but even from those around, we can receive blessings. So be with those who are not here today, but yet at the same time are willing to give to your cause. Help that as we all work together, your name would be uplifted. This house would be a place where people can come and receive, because we would not be withholding corn or anything of that nature from anyone. So bless us now as we give our tithes, our offerings, and whatever gifts we have, as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We now ask the deacons to collect our tithes and offering.
It's a pleasure to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. This morning we are going to continue our worship with a series of songs of praise and worship to God. Our first song will be, "We'll Build on the Rock, the Living Rock, on Jesus, the Rock of Ages." So let's sing together this song, "Build on the Rock."
We'll build on the rock, the living rock, on Jesus, the Rock of Ages. So shall we abide the fearful shock when loud the tempest rages. We will build on the rock. mighty rock. Some build on the sinking sands of life, on visions of earthly treasure. Some build on the ways of sin and strife, of fame and worldly pleasure.
We'll build.
We'll build on the rock. We'll build on the rock. We'll build on the rock, on the solid rock, on Christ the mighty rock. Oh, build on the rock forever sure, the firm and the true foundation. Its hope is the hope which shall endure, the hope of our salvation. We'll build on the rock. We'll build on the rock. We'll build on the rock, on the solid rock, on Christ the mighty rock.
Anchor hold in the storms of life. When the cloud unfolds their wings of strife, when the strong tides lift and the cables strain, will your anchor drift or firm remain? We have an anchor in Jesus Christ today.
Storms of life, when the clouds unfold their wings of strife, when the strong tides lift and the cables strain, will a firm drift or firm breeze? Let's sing. We have an anchor that keeps us. Fasten to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. If this safely moored, will the storm withstand? For 'tis well secured at the Savior's hand, and the cables touched from beneath can defy the blast. Fasten to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. It will firmly hold in the straits of fame, when the breakers tell that the reef is near. Though the tempests rave and the wild winds blow, not an angry shallow back or flow. Come on, we have an anchor.
Let's hear you. You're doing well. Come on.
Which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. It will surely hold in the floods of death. When the waters cold chill our latest breath, on the rising tide it can never fail, while our hopes abide within the...
We have an anchor.
We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock which cannot move, rooted firm and deep in the Savior's love. It will show.
Very good.
Shining gates of pearl or harbor brine, we shall anchor fast to the heavenly shore, where the storms all pass forever. Let's sing. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm.
I want to hear just you singing. We have an anchor. Let's go.
We have an anchor that
very nice.
Steadfast and sure while the bill.
Let's hear those bass rolling.
Fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the same.
Let's sing it again. Come on, let's sing.
We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love.
Amen. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock. Don't you just love that song? That's one of my favorite, to be honest. So let's sing that song. He hideth my soul.
My Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. Of his love and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. He taketh my burdens away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be given me strength as my day.
He hideth my soul.
He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. With numberless blessings each moment he crowns, and filled with his fullness divine, I sing in my rapture, oh glory to God, for such a redeemer as mine.
He hideth my soul.
He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. Salvation is wonderful love. I stand with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shall. shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hiding my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand.
He hiding my soul.
He hiding my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land.
Let's sing that chorus today.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, forever exalted, and
exalted, the King exalted. Amen. On high, God be praised.
Shall we all get in the attitude of prayer as we talk to the Lord? Almighty God, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. We thank you, God, for the privilege of prayer. We thank you that we can come to you this morning in the quietness of this place. Lord, we invite your holy presence to be with us as we meet together, Lord. We pray that our hearts will unite together as we worship you. Father in heaven, there is none like you. You're the only God. You're the one who created the heavens and the earth. You've created us as your children. And so we come this morning to give you thanks, to give you praise. This morning I just want to lift up to you, Lord, those of our brethren that are unable to come out to worship because of ill health and sometimes because of age. We ask, O Lord, that you will be near to them. You will touch them. And Lord, and you will cause them to remember that you promise that you will never leave us nor forsake us. And we thank you for looking after each one of us. This morning, we know that anywhere your people meet, the enemy of souls try to bring about confusion and such things. But I'm asking you, Lord, to beat back the forces of evil. Because as we study this week, that Jesus wins and Satan is a loser. And so we thank you for the privilege of able to call upon you and to claim you, to claim Jesus as our Savior, because he won the battle for us. So help us to keep on trusting and serving with all our hearts. And this morning, Lord, we want to bring before you the one you have chosen to bring your message to us. I pray, dear God, that you will anoint him from his crown of his head to the sole of his feet. May the words that he speaks come directly from your throne of grace. And as we listen, we will apply them to our daily lives. So cover him, I pray, Lord, under the shadow of your wings. Give him utterance. Give him confidence and power to deliver your word. This is our prayer with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church. Our scripture reading is from the book of Exodus. We are reading from, it is chapter 25, and we are reading from verse 1 to verse 8. I read from King James Version. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto children of Israel, that they bring me an offering of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart. You shall take my offering. And this is the offering which you shall take of them, gold and silver and brass, and blue and purple and scarlet and fine linen, and goat's hair and ram's skins dyed red, and badger's skins and steam wood, oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for the sweet incense, onyx stones, and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. Amen. Amen.
The happy privilege is mine today to introduce the speaker for the hour, who is none other than our first elder for the Holloway Church, Elder Floyd Cuffie. He's married with 4 grown-up children, and I can say he's a man of God.
and he tries to walk in the ways of the Lord. There are a few things that I observed, few traits that I observed regarding Brother Cuffie. One of them is, he's a peacemaker. He might not realize it, but I've observed it. He is a peacemaker. And this is a blessing from God. Another area that I noticed, he hunger and thirst after righteousness. And his ambition, I'm sure, one day is to see God. That is his aim. Another thing that I notice, he's very humble. He's not one of those who are a bit robust and throw their weight around. I can say he's very humble. And today, as Brother Cuffie comes to the podium to break the bread of life to us, I pray that you all will give him your undivided attention. But before Brother Cuffie comes to the platform, our special evangelist will bring to us a special in-song. And after that, the next voice you will hear is that of our dear Elder Cuffie. Be blessed. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon, if it is. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. This place is his house. His presence is here. Today, the song I'm going to present to you, was impressed on my heart because somebody here needs to hear. Whatever you've done, wherever you've been, God's grace will always be greater than sin. We're going to be praying for the church. We have been praying, and we are going to be praying even more for this building. But remember that it's not by your might, nor by your power, certainly not by our righteousness, but by the Spirit of God that it will be done. So, when we pray, let's pray in confidence. Because we have confessed our sins, and God has promised that he who confesses and forsakes his sin shall have mercy. His grace is greater than our sin.
In the holy pages, this truth can be found. A promise to stand on when darkness abounds. Right never loses, wrong never wins. Time and again, has a price, and so often we've paid. Oh, but Jesus, he's waiting. Our hope is in him, and God's grace will always be greater than sin. Grace will always be greater than sin.
God's grace is greater than all of our sins. That message of itself is enough for us to go back home now feeling confident. But somebody say amen. Amen. Jesus has proven it time and time again that God's grace is greater than all of our sins. I love Jesus this morning. What about you? Amen. Brother Kelly, thank you very much again for that really comforting and reassuring message. We give God all the honor, praise, and the glory for the talent he has given you, and you are using it to bring honor and glory to his name. So we say amen to you again this morning. Elder Anderson, I really would just like to say thank you for your words of commendation. We live in a world in which it's easier to choose to see the negative things in people. We live in a world that flourishes on the negative. But what joy that the people of God, we look to see how we can empower each other, support each other on the Christian pathway. Amen? So again, thank you very, very much for your words of encouragement and support. It was a night never to be forgotten. It was a night that had come down through time as a symbol of deliverance and triumph. We are all familiar with this well-recorded fact in history, as recorded in the book of Exodus chapter 14, when after the children of Israel were released from bondage, that God did a miraculous thing by opening the Red Sea for them. Would somebody say amen? It tells of how God delivered the children of Israel from slavery to emancipation, from horror to ecstasy. The record speaks of how God protected his chosen people, how the pursuing Egyptian army after them were all drowned in the sea. God has the backs of his children. Will somebody say amen? Amen. We are told, let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear kind Father in heaven, dear Lord, the worship thus far has been so wonderful. Oh Lord, the prayers that have gone to you, the songs, the song service, everything, dear Lord, points our hearts to you. And dear Lord, I stand now before your people. I come with no righteousness of my own, but by faith, by the shed blood of Jesus, I present myself to you. And I'm asking you, dear Lord, just as how each member had willingly surrendered themselves so that they can be used today by you, I'm doing the same now. Remove from me anything that is unlike you. Speak through me to your people. And may we all have a receptive heart as to your message for us today, we pray. And we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, following this incredible experience, we are told in Exodus chapter 15, verses 1 and 2, that Moses, in fact, in the, most of the book of Exodus, but in verses 1 and 2, we are familiar with the song of Moses. It says, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown in the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. I want you to picture the children of Israel as they see the miraculous works of God, as they have now passed through the Red Sea. They are now on dry land, safely away from the enemy. See what it has done to their confidence. They are confident that he who had brought them from the past can safely take them into the future. Amen? In this prophetic passage, the scripture speaks of the song tells of the story of deliverance and looks forward to the conquering of Canaan and bringing God's people to the mountain of his inheritance. In the place, O Lord, which you have made for your own dwelling, the sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established. So now the children are beginning to look towards the promised land, to holy Canaan, their homeland. But significantly in that message, and there's a word here that is used that I want to draw your attention to. It says, the sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established. It is in this prophetic message that scripture speaks of a sanctuary. It's possibly here referring to the holy place of Mount Moriah, later known as Mount Zion. It also looks forward to the time when God's people will dwell with him in the holy city, the New Jerusalem. So yes, triumphantly they have passed through the Red Sea. They are making their way to Canaan. But there's something about the heart of God in all of this. Until then, however, God longed to be with his people. And so as recorded in Exodus chapter 25 and verse 8, he said to Moses, let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. God wanted to dwell in the midst of his people. This sanctuary was not to be of any human devising. As God himself provided a pattern that they were to follow, giving very specific details as recorded in Exodus chapter 25 through to 28. in your own study, you can see, find that there. This special dwelling place became known as the Wilderness Sanctuary, and we are all familiar with it. There is a picture of it on the screen. This was patterned after the heavenly sanctuary, and it served as a vivid illustration of the plan of salvation, which every aspect of its services, every detail of its furnishings, every item of the priests, rich in meaning. It was designed to teach the world of Christ's death on the cross for our sins and the ultimate transference of sin to the one who deserves it, Satan. Through the initiation of the earthly sanctuary service, God instructed the world as to how Christ would handle the sin problem and care for the judgment. And so we are familiar with the sanctuary service and how it was performed. Many hundreds of years after the wilderness sanctuary was established, and I'm just taking us here through a small bit of a historical, because I want to put some things in context. Asaph, a musician and choir leader for King David, referred to the sanctuary as he proclaimed in Psalm 77, verses 13 and 14. Your way, O Lord, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? You are the God who does wonders. The significance of the sanctuary is a theme throughout many of the Psalms. May the Lord answer you in the time of trouble. May he send you help from the sanctuary and strengthen you out of Zion. May he remember all your offerings and accept your burnt offerings, proclaimed David in Psalm 20, verses 1 to 3. And in Psalm 96 and verse 4, we read, honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. The services that had been carried out in the wilderness sanctuary continued in Solomon's temple that we're all familiar with, and later in what became known as the Second Temple, rebuilt following the Babylonian captivity of 70 years. Now, it was this temple complex, greatly enlarged by Herod the Great, where Jesus first witnessed the awe-inspiring sanctuary services. Now, this is significant because at the age of 12, it was a time for Jesus to, yes, go and to visit the sanctuary, the tabernacle then, and to begin and to be recognized at the age of 12 that he was able and that it was possible for him to begin to develop a personal relationship with the Lord. And I want you to recognize the significance that would have had on him as a child for the first time, looking at this beautiful sanctuary with all of its services. It says here, he saw the white-robed priests performing the solemn ministry. He beheld the bleeding victim upon the altar of sacrifice. With the worshippers, he bowed in prayer while the cloud of incense ascended before God. He witnessed the impressive rites of the paschal service. Day by day, he saw their meaning more clearly. Every act seemed to be bound up with his own life. The mystery of his mission was opening before the Savior. So it's important for us to realize and acknowledge the significance that the sanctuary had on Jesus' impressionable years as a child. It opened up to him the significance of his life and the role that he had to play. How significant is the sanctuary? Let's press on. 21 years after the first visit to the temple, Christ himself became the Passover lamb. Would somebody say amen? Type met antitype. The temple curtain was torn from top to bottom, according to Matthew chapter 27 and verse 51, indicating the purpose of the earthly sanctuary services were fulfilled, and no longer Jesus. Jesus became the sacrifice for you and for me. Amen? The ceremonial services, the services as conducted in the sanctuary, in the temple, was now ended. No longer was there need for us to sacrifice a lamb. No longer was there to do any type of sacrifices. Why? Because Jesus had become the lamb sacrifice from the beginning of the world. As we read in Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 19, it says that Christ entered into that within the veil, in the holy place, doing his work of mediation. Then according to the prophecy of Daniel chapter 8 and verse 14, it says, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. He entered the most holy place and began his final work of judgment and ministry on our behalf. Somebody also needs to say amen here this morning. And that's the significance of us as a church. That's the significance why we have been established, that Jesus has left heaven, in fact, even came down to this earth, took on human form, sacrificed on the cross of Calvary as our Savior, but now he has entered into the most holy place in heaven, and what is he doing? He is now our high priest and interceding on every one of us. But you know something, brethren, the world doesn't know that. You and I know because we have studied. And that's why God has appointed the church, the Seventh-day Adventist church, a remnant church with a specific message for a specific time. The three angels' message as found in Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 to 12. That's our responsibility. You know, Sister Ellen White reminds us, she says, the church is God's appointed agency for the salvation of men. It was organized for service, and its mission is to carry the gospel to the world. Significantly then was the sanctuary services, and it pointed to a savior who was to be sacrificed, who became the Paschal lamb, for you and for me. But now that he is in heaven serving as our high priest, a responsibility has been placed on you and I to let the world know what is happening before their very eyes. And that's why we need a church and a church building. That's why it becomes significant for us to have a church that enables and empowers its members to carry out the services that Christ expects of us. How simple it is for us to see the church as a place we can come every Sabbath morning. Could be. And yet we lose the real significance as to why we are here. But then if we appreciate the significance why we are here, then we need to see the significance as to why we need to have a sanctuary that enables us to be used by God to do a great work for him. Would somebody say amen? Amen. There are three areas that is significant as a church, if we are to be a church, that must be fulfilled. The first one is edification in relation to individual discipleship and growth. The church is to encourage individual, as a church we are to encourage each other in faith and relationship with Christ. With this goal in mind, Paul prayed that the Ephesian congregation will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself into love as each part does its work. The author of Hebrews exhorts his readers to assemble regularly. He pointed to the purpose of giving mutual encouragement when he said, "Let us consider how we may spur one another towards love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another." To be able to encourage each other, it's important that we meet in a place where we can do so. So the building, the church building, is important in encouraging love one for the other. Where men and women of different nationalities, different cultures, could come together and fellowship with each other, understand the needs of each other, pray with each other, and support each other on the Christian pathway. Would somebody say amen?
Amen.
But also, the church is about building community. In the New Testament, the people of God were referred to as the church. And so in our local congregation, our fellowship is to display the holiness of God through our individual holiness. God's love is to be reflected in the love we show for one another. The unity of God is to be reflected in their own unity. Jesus said it, "By this shall all men know that you are my" what? "Disciples," when you do what? We show love one for the other. How easy it is for us to be able to love our families and friends. But then it becomes much more difficult when we are called to love the unlovely, isn't it? But Jesus never considered any of these when he chose to die. Never he did. One of the things that thrills my soul is to know that Jesus would have come and died for the worst of sinners. Yes. It means then, brethren, that we should develop an attitude in the way we deal with one another. Amen? The unity of God is to be reflected in their own unity. The fellowship of believers in a congregation should be a partnership in laboring. And listen to these words, brethren. It's not about sentimentalism. It's not about feelings. But listen to the word that is used here. The fellowship of believers in a congregation should be in partnership in laboring for mutual edification and for faithfulness in evangelism. Brethren, we are called to work. And thirdly, and so that's why, brethren, we need to have a church building. Why? So that there could be training, so that we can come together, share our experiences, so that we are able to grow, live. You know, for example, one of the beautiful things, I love to study the life of Jesus, and one of the beautiful things Jesus would love to do is that he would send the disciples out, and then he would wait to get their experiences. As they share their experiences with each other, it allowed them to grow. Each other's experience became a learning for each other. So think about it when it happens, brethren, when we go out into the fields, when we share the good news of salvation, when we talk with each other, when we go through life experiences, and when they impact our lives, and you can meet a brother and or a sister who can say to you, you know, this is my problem, and you can say, "I do empathize with you, my brother," or "I do empathize with me, my sister, because I have been through the same. But listen, I have learned to trust the Lord." Amen? Amen. "I have seen this calamity turn into victory." Why? Because I've trusted in God. And we support each other on the Christian pathway. Amen? But thirdly, brethren, this building, a church building, is required for evangelism. Another purpose for our congregation is to bring God's words to those outside. Jesus commanded his disciples, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all things that I have commanded you." And there's a point here that I just like to touch on, in the sense that, you know, teaching them to observe whatsoever I have commanded you. Fellow believers, For someone to be baptized, they must understand who Jesus is. They must understand some of the basic teachings of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But never forget, brethren, that the teaching continues. And you know, sometimes, as a church, sometimes we make this mistake. The mistake in that we get people baptized, we are happy that they are baptized, but then after that, so this is something the building is designed to enable us to be able to do, to equip ourselves efficiently, in whether it be in terms of conservation of members, whatever, so that we are able to keep those whom we have labored for. People need to know that Jesus is their savior, but also their high priest, interceding for them in the most holy place, in the heavenly sanctuary. They won't know this if we don't tell them. That's why we have been set apart. That's why we are called members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We have a special message for a special time. Reflecting on our church here at Holloway, reflecting at our church here in Holloway, just bear with me, please. So as we were saying, the good news spreads most naturally, not only where the congregation holds its services, but where its members live out their weekdays. Our lives should be known by non-Christian friends, neighbors, and colleagues. Our Christianity, our being called Seventh-day Adventists, should reflect in the way we live from day to day. Their lives should be known by non-Christian friends, neighbors, and colleagues. Their witness should be improved as all these outsiders constantly observe their conduct. And so, for many years, this congregation has been the conduit of God's grace. You know, I remember I think it was 1999, when I'm from Trinidad, and where I'm from, I belong to a very small congregation. And so when I walked into this church then, and when I looked around and I saw the awesomeness of this church, I said there and then, I'm sure here is where my family has to come. Beautiful people, beautiful setting. I remember you'd come to church on a Sabbath morning, but you've got to come early or because you may miss being able to fit into a Sabbath school class. Yes. Sabbath school classes were lined up all over. That's how we were. I remember oftentimes we had to open upstairs for the midday services. The question is, over the years, this church building has served its purpose. But given its age, given the needs of our congregation and community, which is fast changing, is this present building fit for purpose? You can answer if you wish to. Is this church fit for purpose? Does it meet the need for worship, fellowship, training, health, etc.? But also, when we look at the building, I would say from the time I've come here to know, this building has gone down. Would you say that this building at its present state reflects the awesomeness of the character of God we serve? You know, Sister White made a very, very important statement. Hear what she says. If the buildings erected correspond to the truth that we are proclaiming, a telling influence will be exerted on minds. Actions speak louder than words. What is this building saying about us and the God we serve? You know, the children of Israel had to ask themselves a similar question. After being freed from human bondage, God spoke to Moses, and it was important that there be a sanctuary, a tabernacle, in which God could dwell, but also show forth his greatness and his majesty and power. Moses instructed the children of Israel, God instructed Moses. But what was the attitude of the people? What was the attitude of the people when Moses instructed them on God's requirements? I'm going to spend some time just reading to you the answer to that question. It's found in the scriptures. Exodus chapter 35. For the building of this sanctuary, when God instructed them to build, make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. For the building of the sanctuary, great and expensive preparation were necessary. A large amount of the most precious and costly materials were required. Yet listen to this, and this is important. Yet the Lord accepted only freewill offerings. Brethren, God really don't need our money, you know. You know that. What God wants is our heart. And once God has our heart, he has our everything. Then our money would be secondary to ourselves, but it would be to the service of the Lord. Of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart, yea, shall take my offering, was the divine commanded and repeated by Moses to the congregation. Devotion to God and a spirit of sacrifice were the first requisites in preparing a dwelling place for the highest. Let me read that over. Devotion to God and a spirit of sacrifice were the first requisites in preparing a dwelling place for the Most High. What was the people's response to Moses? All the people responded with one accord. They came, everyone whose heart stirred him up, and everyone whom his spirit made willing, and they brought the Lord's offering to the work of the tabernacle of the congregation, and all his service and all his holy garments. And they came, both men and women, as many as were willing-hearted, and brought bracelets and earrings and rings and tablets and jewels of gold. And every man that offered an offering of gold unto the Lord. And every man with whom was found blue and purple and scarlet and fine linen and goat's hair and ram skins, dyed red and seal skins brought them. Everyone that did offer an offering of silver and brass brought the Lord's offering. And every man with whom was found acacia wood for any work of the service brought it. All the women that were wise-hearted did spin their hands and brought that which they had spun, the blue and the purple, the scarlet and the fine linen. And all the women whose hearts stirred them up in wisdom spun the goat's hair. And the rulers brought the onyx stones and the stones to be set for the ephod and the breastplate and the spice and the oil, for the light and for the anointing oil and the sweet incense. While the building of the sanctuary was in progress, the people old and young, listen to this, old and young, men, women, and children, continued to bring their offerings until those in charge of the work found that they had enough and even more that could be used. And Moses caused to proclaim throughout the camp let neither man nor woman make any more work for the offering of the sanctuary. So the people were restrained from bringing. Yeah. That's marvelous, isn't it? Yeah. The Lord made a request. But what it proved is that the Lord never ever make a request of his people without knowing how it would be provided. And this is what he did. He placed beforehand in the hands of those who he were calling to build the sanctuary what was required. Ellen White has made a statement. She says, all the money or all the means that are necessary for the work of God are in the pockets or in the hands of his children. The question is, to what extent you and I, mother and father, husband and wife, sons and daughter, grandparents, all young, how much are we concerned about this sanctuary as it looks to us? You know, I was standing here, I think it's about 3 Sabbaths ago, amazingly, and I felt something drop on my head. So I jokingly thought, am I about to have a upper room experience or something? It dawned on me, brethren, it was the rain that was falling. We're going to have to thank God that among us, for over the many years, we have found in us a pastor who has been able to speak to us and enable us and bring us to a place, brethren, where by the grace of God, we would have a much improved sanctuary soon. Would somebody say amen? Amen. That's the response, brethren. We are committed. We thank you for Sister Miguel and the team, the church building team, for the work that they have done that have brought us thus far. Sooner or later, fellow believers in Christ, then each one of us would need to play our part for the finishing of this sanctuary. And it would be an honor for us to be part of it, brethren. Making a sacrificial offering to our Heavenly Father. I'm sure our pastors and the team are going to bring more information to us as to how we would go about raising funds and all of that. I'm appealing to you, brethren, that it is from now that you start to plan. Plan how you're going to give. Start making that provision so when the time comes and you are asked, you are ready and available to make that contribution. Would somebody say amen? Amen? You know, as I close, let me just read this to us. We have no command from God to erect a building that will compare for richness and splendor with the temple gone by. But we are to build a humble house of worship, plain and simple, neat and perfect in its design. Then let those who have means look to it that they are as liberal and tasteful in erecting a temple wherein we may worship God, as they have been in locating and building the furnishing of their own houses. Let them manifest a willingness and desire to show greater honor to God than themselves. Let them build a nice, and listen to this, let them build a nicety, these are the words of Ellen White back then, nicety, but not with extravagance. Let the house be built conveniently and thoroughly, so that when it's presented to God, we can accept it and let the Spirit rest upon the worshipers who have an eye single to the glory of God. Let everyone, old and young, bring gifts and donations to help in building a house for God. So this church building, as much as it had served its purpose in being the headquarters of the BUC and being the church of, is it North London, Pastor? North London Seventh-day Adventist Church. And though it has come through the countless ages, while it served its purpose, and I'm talking about the structure now, while it served its purpose effectively, yet now, brethren, given the needs of the church, brethren, the needs of the community, our building is no longer fit for purpose. So God wants us to have a building that enables us to really maximize our spiritual gifts in serving the community. May the Lord richly bless us and help us when the time comes that we would be as willing as the children of Israel to give all in a sacrificial way to see his name honored and glorified. God bless you. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Cuffie. I hope we've taken note of what was said. There's a special song that I like very much. It goes like this: "Of all that I have, belong to God. Therefore, all that He has is mine." So let us remember that. Whatever we have in this world, it belongs to God. We cannot hoard things and say it's mine for a while. It will stay while you're alive, but when you go, you can't take it with you. Yes, so whatever we can do, let us do it now. We do need a building that is representative of the God we serve. So let us give of our best and do what we can. In Jesus' name. Our closing hymn is number 608. And I'd like to thank you, Brother Cuffie, for that powerful message. 608, faith is a victory. Without faith, it is impossible to please God.
The battle here and now, your grace and glorious God.
Dear kind Father in heaven, we continue to commit our lives into your hands and to thank you, dear loving Father, to be part of this wondrous organization, your organization, the church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, who you have endowed with this great responsibility of proclaiming the three angels' message, of informing the world, dear Lord, that we are living in the time of the investigative judgment. But dear Lord, you want us to do it in a way that meets their needs. You want us to do it in a way that would allow us to be effective in our approach. And dear Lord, we know that we have seen throughout the history that your sanctuary has always played a significant part in the message being told to those who do not know you. So this morning, dear loving Father, we have reminded ourselves of the need to have a sanctuary that is fit for purpose. Oh Lord, but you have reminded through the spirit of prophecy that in our hands and in our pockets are the means by which you can finish the work. And so, dear Lord, I'm asking that you'd make us to be liberal. Help us, dear Lord, that our hearts, like the children of Israel, that we be willing to give, but that you would also provide the means necessary, oh Lord, so that your name would be glorified, a sanctuary would be built that that has purpose, that would meet the needs of our children, that we can find opportunities where we can find places where our children can be taught, dear Lord, where our juniors can be taught, where our children can, or where our youths can have places that they can have fellowship. Dear Lord, that we can have a sanctuary that is fit for purpose, dear Lord, and provides all the necessary amenities, dear Lord, so the work could be effectively be done. You have called us and you have tasked us, and we know, dear Lord, that you have provided the means for it to be done. So we just want to thank you. Give us faith, dear Lord, to follow you. Where we can't see you, we pray, and we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I think it's a prayer emphasis. And so therefore, I don't know what time you've done. I think a meal is provided after the prayer session in the youth hall, so you get something warm. It's a little bit cold. And so before we go, we're just going to sing 216 while we go home, those of us who are going. I hope we'll all stay back and enjoy the prayer.
We're going to meet back here at 1:30 for praying and fasting session.
Okay. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, sorry, musician number 216, you just decided to 216. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. And I hope this is a prayer of all of us. When Jesus comes, we'd see him face to face.
See? When the trumpet of